I am Nankishore Dude, working as a program officer at EIACP BNHS. So EIACP stands for Environment Information Awareness Capacity Building and Livelihood Program. So I am a humble host for the today's event. In our team, we have Ms. Natasha Girkar. She is an information officer. Mr. Suraj Gosavi, he is our IT officer, and Pooja Gosavi, she is our data entry operator. So, dear participants, I would like to add that your active participation is important throughout the session, and the purpose of the webinar to make you aware of various aspects of biogeographic of Indian birds. So, I request you all, the participants, to keep your laptop, desktop or mobile camera. Mostly the microphone is in off mode. So I again welcome you all on behalf of our organization, that is Bombay Natural History Society. So I would like to introduce our today's speaker, Mr. Asif Khan. As a passionate birder, Mr. Asif Khan has committed to our conservation and education at the program department of BNHS since 2021. So he is involved in planning and executions, wildlife and educational trips across all over India and 7 countries for BNHS member. Mostly those who are BNHS member, those who will get this opportunity. And through this webinar, I would like to request you all, you can take our BNHS membership so you can avail all these opportunity. Before going to start, I would like to introduce our EIACP center. So here you can see the EIACP stand for Environment Information Awareness Capacity Building and Livelihood Program. This program was established at BNHS in 1996. And it is funded by Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. So I request the participant, please do not share your screen. Sorry, I will share my screen again. So here you can see. So in our stop, as I already told you, so in our program, like we have published Bucero's newsletter, which is a triannual newsletter. It's cover the articles related to avian ecology. Also, we have developed the, here you can see the few publications. All are the special publication. It's highlighted a particular area, like Odisha's state special issue. It covers the entire wetland which is found in Odisha. Recently, we had published one special issue on Jammu and Kashmir, wetlands of Jammu and Kashmir. And now we are working on the power line. So like
Nandkishore ji, sorry for interrupting. Presentation mode pe dal sakte ho, so it can have a better view of the PowerPoint.
Oh, yeah, extremely sorry. So now it's visible?
Yes, sir, visible.
Okay, thank you. So sometimes due to some internet issue, it will get... So here you can see the publications. Here there are more publications. So in last year we had published one special booklet like "Aar Marusal Ke Vanne Jeev Ek Jhalak." So it's covered the wildlife, flora and fauna which is found in the Thar desert area. So all three mobile app we have developed, and all three app are available on our Google Play Store. So here you can see the left side app, you can see the data collection app. This app will be useful for the researcher, basically those who are working in the field. That time they have to face a lot of problems. They have to use the manual data sheet. So to reduce their efforts, we have developed this app. Second app will be based on the bird identification app. It will help to identify birds based on the habitat. So we have categorized in four habitat, like urban habitat, wetland, forest, and grassland. So you can avail this opportunity. Okay. So,
Dandakishwarji, your presentation is not in the presentation mode, it seems.
Yes, sir.
The slideshow, it is not in slideshow.
Slideshow mode.
Yes, see.
Okay, so now it's visible.
Yes, right.
Okay, sorry for this technical error. So here you can see the multiple publications. All are available on our website. At the end, we will share the link of the website so that you can download all our publications. So this booklet also available on our website. So here you can see the three maps. As I told you, first one is a data collection app, which app will be useful for the researcher. Second app will be based on the bird identification app. And this app you used by the mostly the amateur bird watcher. It's will helpful for them because we have categorized the habitat into four categories like wetland, urban, grassland, and forest habitat. So we have added number of filters. With the help of the filter, you can identify the birds, and we have added the more than 300 species information, including photographs. And for third app is based on the AV Eco base. This app also useful for the researcher. Basically, those who are interested in writing articles or research paper, that time they want they required a lot of references. So AV Eco base, we have added more than 27,000 references. So you can download all the references based on the species or based on areas. We added here also we added multiple filters. So all three apps are available on our Play Store. So these are basic information about EIACP project. So I request Mr. Asif Khan, please continue the presentation.
Oh, thank you so much, Nandakishwar. And thank you so much for inviting me to give this talk. I hope I am audible to you guys.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sure. So,
yes, sir, you're audible.
So, just keep yourselves on mute during the talk so there's no disturbance from the background noise. And I would also request you that if you can turn your videos off, you'll get better network while the presentation is on. So just give me a minute before I share my Hello, I just wanted to check whether you guys can see my screen, because once I go in the presentation mode, I won't be able to see the chat window.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sure. So let's begin. Okay, so biogeography is a very interesting field. Interestingly, I started getting interested in biogeography during one of the special issues that I wrote with Ranjit sir, which was incidentally a BioScholar issue, and it is available online as well on the website. So when you talk about biogeography, what does it include? So it essentially includes everything, aspects in terms of plants and animals. So before we go into biogeography, let us get into what exactly is geography. Geography is all aspects of the earth. So it includes things like landform, water, climate, the soil, which together are called abiotic or non-living features of the geography. And then you have plants and
ऍक्च्युअली जे आपल्या मॅडम आहे ना सोनाली मॅडम ने दोन गोष्टी सजेस्ट केल्या होत्या. हा तर सर तुम्ही त्याच्यातून सजेस्ट करू शकता का, कारण त्यांनी ते थोडस करेक्ट केलेलं आहे टेक्स्ट टायटल मध्ये. हा तर मी आपल्या ग्रुपवर टाकला कॉर्डिनेटर ग्रुपवर. हा तर मग बस त्याच्यातून तुम्ही जर फायनल केलं की मग आपण
Hi, sorry for that interruption. So, as I was saying, so the entire geography includes the abiotic factors, and then you have the plants, animals, microbes, which form a biotic or the living feature of the entire earth. So this part is known as biogeography. Now, essentially, biogeography is not only the living things that are present on the earth, but also their distribution and dispersal of these factors across the earth. And how does the climate, how does the landform, how do the features like mountains and ocean affect them? So given that, the entire earth is divided into what we call the biogeographical realms, or also called ecozones. Now, these are large landforms which share some characteristic and distinct patterns of biogeography or of biodiversity. So we go through the biogeographical realms that are present on Earth. So the first one is the Indo-Malayan realm, or the Indo-Malayan ecozone, which includes, as you can see, India. Let me see if I can get a pointer so I can just point out the features. So it includes India and parts of Southeast Asia, China. So this region and entire region is known as the Indo-Malayan realm. The next realm that we'll talk about is the Palearctic realm. Now the word Palearctic comes from two words. Palea means old, and Arctic means the Arctic realm, which includes Europe, Russia, and parts of the Himalayas. So this realm features a very unique climate with conifer forests and birds which have adapted, birds and animals actually, which have adapted to this realm. The next we come to the Afrotropical realm, which actually encompasses the sub-Saharan tropical area and Madagascar. Then you get to the Neo-Arctic. So this is very similar to Palearctic, but as you know, the but can you see the slides? Can you see the slides? So the Neo-Arctic, as you know, the Americas, the North and the South Americas. Just give me a minute. It seems that there's a technical issue. The presentation is stuck on the first slide. Let me just stop sharing and reshare it. Okay, I'm going in full screen. Okay, so I hope you guys can see the slide. I'll be changing the slide once and coming back to see if you can see the change happening. Okay, so sorry for that technical issue. So as you know, the North and South America is known as the New World and the rest is known as the Old World. So the word Neo means new, New Arctic. So this, the name should give you a clue that the habitat and the climatic condition of the Neo Arctic region, which encompasses North America and Greenland, the climatic conditions are similar. But since the birds and animals of the New World or the North and South America is very different from the the Old World, so you have different animals living here in spite the climate being very similar. And similarly, you have the Neotropic or the Neotropic region, which encompasses the South America. Then we come to a very interesting realm, which is very unique, which is the Australasian realm. Now, interestingly, it encompasses the Australian region and the Guinea region. And it stops right at Borneo. I hope you guys can see the pointer. So, interestingly, this area where though the gap is very small, but and even with similar climate, the animals are, and even the birds are very different from what you see in Borneo and the Indo-Malayan region and the Australian region. Now, the small strait that separates it is also called as Wallace Line. This had confused a lot of people in the past. But later on, when the plate tectonics and how the world and the tectonic plates have moved closer to each other and further away from each other, it was very clear because this entire region fits on a separate plate, which was much further south and which moved moved over time closer to the Indo-Malayan region. That's why the animals and the birds that developed in this region were very different from what you get in the Indo-Malayan zone. In spite of it being separated by a very thin line, and it shows that it can be easily crossed by at least the birds. Next is another very interesting realm, which is the Antarctic realm. It's as you know, it's a very arid and desolated realm, but still it has its own climatic features, and because of that, it's unique bird life that is present there. Then you have a realm which is sometimes considered as a separate realm or ecozone, or sometimes it is encompassed in the Australian realm, which is the Oceania, which includes all these islands in the Pacific Ocean, which has unique features but also shares birds and animals from other realms like Australian or the Neotropic. So just to give you an idea, this is a map that I have put up of all the realms. You have the New World, which is North and South America, the Neotropic and the Neotropic and the Neoarctic realm. You have the Palearctic realm right here. You have the Indo-Malayan, which stops at Borneo right here, the Australian realm, and the Afrotropical realm. Now, coming back to the geography of India, which I'm sure that almost everyone is very familiar with because we have been grilled on it in our school days. But essentially, the main features, the predominant features of the Indian subcontinent or India would be the Himalayas, which are situated in the north of the country, the Indo-Gangetic Plain, which is the flat area of the Ganges River, the Brahmaputra River, and the Indus River. So this entire region is the Indo-Gangetic Plain. Just south of that, you get the Deccan Plateau, which is a raised part of the Indian region, from the coast and the Indo-Gangetic plains. Then you have the Deccan Plateau, which is part, then you have the coastal and the islands. So the entire coast and the two chain of islands that we have, the Lakshadweep and the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Now this, be today being the World Sparrow Day, I thought I'll include a few slides on the sparrows. So as we're talking about the New World and the Old World, the sparrows as a whole is mostly divided into, broadly divided into these two categories. So the New World sparrows, which has sparrows like the white-crowned sparrow, and you have the Old World sparrow, which is a house sparrow. Now, the reason why I've kept the house sparrow here, in spite you all know that the house sparrow is distributed all over the world, is because the house sparrow is essentially a sparrow of the Old World, only of this region. It has been introduced in the New World and it has successfully proliferated all over the place. But essentially, this is the Old World sparrow. Now, sparrow essentially belongs to an order called as Passeriformes, which consists of a huge number of birds, including finches and snow finches. But the true sparrows come from a specific genus, which is Passer genus. From this genus, there are 28 species that are found worldwide, actually from the Old World, because the true sparrows, as they call it, is found only on the Old World. Out of the 28 species in India, we have 5 of them. We'll learn about them as I go through the regions. I'll also tell you which sparrows are found in which region. So the biogeographical zones of India is further divided into smaller categories, but we'll look at these broad biogeographical realms, which are approximately 10 of them. So as I told you, the Himalayas, the Gangetic Plain, you have the region of the desert and the arid region in the northwest of India, the Deccan Plateau, which also has a separate biogeographical zone, which is called the Central Highlands. You have the coastal region, which we had divided into the east and the west coast, because the birds that are found in these regions are a bit different than it's found in the other places. And then you have Sri Lanka, if you're talking about the subcontinent as a whole. And then you have the chain of islands, the Lakshadweep and the Andaman and Nicobar, which are usually clubbed together, but they have vastly different types of birds that are found in both the areas. So we'll go through these biogeographical zones in India in terms of birds, not other animals, step by step. So the first region that I would like to talk about is one of my favorites, the Himalayan region. So the Himalayan region can essentially be divided into multiple zones. So from east to west, these zones can be divided into the Trans-Himalayan region, which has a climate of very dry climate. Imagine Ladakh, a very barren landscape. Then you have the Greater Himalayas, which is the main chunk of your Himalayas that spread throughout the Himalayan region. The Lesser Himalayas, which is just below the Greater Himalayas. The height is a bit less, the forest is a bit different. And then you have a very interesting feature, which is called the Outer Himalaya or the Shivalik Hills, which stretches from the west till Sikkim. So these are a chain of hills that are found just below the Himalayas, but not a part of the Himalayas. So imagine the Doon Valley. If you have ever traveled in Uttarakhand, you can see this very clearly. Is once you cross a ghat, once you climb over a mountain, there's a huge patch of flat land, which is called the Doon Valley. And then you start climbing again if you want to go further north. So this huge part of flat land divides the Shivalik Hills and the main Himalayas. So one of the best places to see a distinct divide between the two is the area of the Doon Valley, Rajaji National Park, all these areas. So the birds that are found in the Himalayas are also varied because it's divided into multiple areas. Oh, I'm going back a slide. So interestingly, this is not the only way you can divide the Himalayas. The Himalayas in terms of bird can also be divided into the western zone, the central, and the eastern. So sometimes the northeast hills also consist the eastern Himalayas and the northeast hills. So the birds of the Trans-Himalayan region are more closely related to the Palearctic bird. So you have these partridges, snowcocks, finches, the Tibetan sand grouse, the choughs, and then again you have the main bird of the region, so the black-necked cranes. Of the main Himalayas, the lesser and the greater Himalayan, you have birds mostly of forest region, because these areas are predominantly dominated by broadleaf forests. So you have birds like your magpies, your broadbills, you have your warblers from here, you have your ibisbill and your foxtails, and many flycatchers from this region, because they breed in that region and then kind of migrate further south in India to other regions. Then you have the northeast, which is influenced very heavily by the other regions in Burma and Thailand. So you have a lot of trogons, laughing thrushes, nuthatches and tits, and especially birds like parrotbill, which is predominant in this area. So the sparrows that are
seen... Sir, sorry for interrupting. Somebody presented, so your presentation is gone back.
Okay, I'll just wait till...
So I request the participant, please do not share your screen. I again request to all participants. So please, Asif sir, you can share your screen again.
Okay, so let me just stop sharing and share again. You can see my screen, right?
Yes.
So, okay. I'm going in presentation mode. Okay. So, the sparrow predominantly that are seen in this region are the russet sparrow, which is found throughout the Himalayas, and it's a pretty common bird. The Eurasian tree sparrow, and of course, the house sparrow, which I think so will be... constant member in almost all the regions. The next region that we come to is the Indo-Gangetic Plains. Now, unfortunately, the Indo-Gangetic Plain, there are only a few places in the entire country that you can truly see what the Indo-Gangetic Plain used to look like. But earlier, it used to encompass the Indus Valley, the Ganga River Basin, and the Brahmaputra River Basin, which goes all the way down south, which ends at the Sundarbans. Now, because this region is a river basin, it is very good for grasses. So the habitat of this region is predominantly grass. Now, since this habitat is so excellent in growing grass, humans started cultivating it, because we essentially grow and feed on our favorite grass, which is the wheat. So this region has been completely devastated by fields. So there are only a few places like the Dudhwa National Park or the Kaziranga National Park where you can actually see these habitats intact. This region also has a lot of smaller and large water bodies which play host to migratory birds. So if you see the birds that are found, you will see a lot of migratory birds and few specialty birds like the Saras crane or the white-tailed stonechat, the Finn's weaver, the grass bird, and you have, and of course, the Bengal florican, and species that inhabit river chains like the Indian skim. The predominant sparrow species of this region is the Eurasian tree sparrow, which is more confined to the northeast, and of course the house sparrow. The next region that I would like to talk about is the desert and the semi-arid region. Also, you can call it the arid and the semi-arid region. Now, this region is also one of my favorite because the one predominant region is that this ecozone or this biogeographical region is the most misunderstood by the general public. So this area is many a times referred to as barren and wasteland, but this area without any trees or without any predominant features plays an excellent habitat for a certain number of species. So in India, this region is confined to the northwest. So you have your Thar desert, which has only one river running through it, the Aravalli range, and the semi-arid region, which touches upon the Indo-Gangetic plains. So the birds that you see here are desert-dwelling birds mostly. So you have the Great Indian Bustard, the Huvara Bustard, which is a migratory species, and a lot of raptors. In terms of this, you have the white nape or the pied tit, a lot of larks from this region, and of course the nightjars. In terms of sparrow diversity, this is also a very interesting region because you get two species of sparrow that are found only in this region, the Spanish sparrow and the sin sparrow. And of course, the house sparrow is always there. The next region is the Central Highlands. So the Central Highlands is this area of mountainous region which is sandwiched between the Indo-Gangetic Plain and the Deccan Plateau. So it consists mostly of the Vindhya and the Satpura range, and it ends at the Chota Nagpur Plateau. Now this region has played a very crucial role in acting as a highway between the Northeast region and the Western Ghats. So we'll talk more about how this has played a very important role. But the only thing that you need to remember at the moment is the habitat of this region is very wooded. So it's a forest habitat with a lot of mountainous terrains. So the birds that you find in this region is, again, as you can see, forest birds. You have the black eagle, you have the spotted creeper, you have the forest owlet, which was recently discovered, and the Malabar whistling thrush, the drongos, and minivets. Then we come down to the Deccan Plateau region. So the Deccan Plateau region is this highland area, which is sandwiched between the Western and the Eastern Ghats and the Central Highlands. And the birds that you predominantly find here is essentially the Great Indian Bustard used to have a very strong presence in this region, but it has been reduced and now only predominantly found in the northwestern region. You find a lot of harriers here, lapwing, coursers, and a lot of birds that are much similar to your semi-arid region. Then we come to the Western Ghats. Now the Western Ghats, as you know, is situated all along the western coast of India. Now, interestingly, the main feature of the Western Ghats, which separates us from the Eastern Ghat, is that it is very continuous in nature. So it has only one major gap, which is called the Palghat Gap. Otherwise, this region acts as a wall or a barrier, which is very continuous. And a lot of rivers originate from here and flow towards the east. And because these rivers originate in Western Ghats and flow towards the east, they have cut up the Eastern Ghats in places. That's why the Eastern Ghats is very disjointed compared to the Western Ghats. Now, the birds of these areas are the Malabar parakeet, a lot of endemics in this area. So the Malabar trogon, the white-cheeked barbet, the rufous-bellied eagle, and many birds which are also found in the northeast. This is a very interesting phenomenon that we are going to talk about ahead. Now, coming back to the Eastern Ghats, as I told you, it stretches right all along the eastern coast, and it's a very disjointed Ghats. Then you get to the coast. The coast can be divided into rocky, sandy beaches, mudflats, and the mangrove. And the birds of this region are many migratory birds and some specialty species birds like the mangrove whistler that you can see here. Talking about the islands, now the islands, though they are combined into one biogeographical zone, they are very starkly different. Now, if you see the Lakshadweep islands, they are something what we call atolls. So atolls are these coral islands that are formed, and in terms of vegetation and habitat is very less compared to the Andaman Islands. Because of this, these regions do not have a very varied bird life in terms of native bird life. So predominantly the birds that you see are sea-dwelling birds like the tropic bird and the nudies, and a few birds that have kind of escaped or have hopped on to this island, like the white eye and the Asian quail. Now, the Andaman and Nicobar Island are a bit more interesting because it has a distinct habitat. It shares a lot of its features from the Indonesia and those regions. So the birds that you see are also very, a lot of endemics are found here, and it also has the only megapod species in our country, which is a Nicobar megapod, and a lot of endemics like the Narcodum hornbill, the Andaman creeper, the Andaman teal, the white-headed starling, also called the Andaman starling, the Andaman woodpecker, and birds like the Nicobar pigeon, which essentially is not endemic to the Andaman Island, but it's got its name from the Nicobar Island. Now, going ahead, I also wanted to talk about the colonization of India, but by birds. So, if you remember your school geography, you'll also remember that the Indian plate slammed into the Eurasian plate, and it formed the Himalayas. This is a story that is very famous. But a few key features that is very important to note is that the Indian plate moved quite fast, fast in terms of how fast the plates move compared to the other plates. And once it smashed into the Eurasian plate, which was about 10 million years ago. Now, before it smashed into the Eurasian plate, there were no birds. So all the birds that you are found in India have essentially colonized India later. So you see influence of a lot of birds in India. So the three major regions that influence the avifauna of India are the Orient birds, the Palearctic birds, and the Saharo-African birds. So if you see all the species in India, they currently fall between these three areas. So the Palearctic birds, which inhabited places like cold and dry places like the northern Himalayan region of Ladakh and other regions. And the birds that we are talking about are finches, tits, accenters, snowcocks, snow partridges. Sorry. The next influence came from the Saharo-African or the Arabian region, which are birds which like dry, warm weather and arid habitats. So all your bustards, larks, babblers, and sand grouses. And many of the birds that you find in India are from the Orient region, so which preferred your warm and wet habitats, essentially a tropical habitat. So all your warblers, leaf birds, malpohas, and pipits are from this region. So let me just skip ahead. So let me just show you something interesting. So if you see the Eurasian magpie, it's essentially a Palearctic bird. So if you go on the eBird site and if you type in Eurasian magpie and you see the distribution, you can see where the influence has come from. So the Eurasian magpie is essentially a Palearctic bird and also found in the Trans-Himalayan region. Similarly, if you see the goldfinch, again, you can see the same pattern. So a Palearctic bird which has kind of colonized India through the Himalayas. Now, if you see the sand grouses, so the chestnut-bellied sand grouse, you can see how it's distributed in the Arabian region, and essentially it came through here and colonized India in similar habitats all over the country. The Hubara bustard, again, is a migratory species, but you can see it's Arabian influence. Now, let me talk about diffusion of species through the region. So, talking about the Orient birds, so the hanging parrot, earlier both these species used to be one species, and then later on, with the process of speciation, when the two populations were separate enough, they formed two different species. Now, we can see that path just by searching the distribution of these two birds. So if you see, the vernal hanging parrot comes from the Orient region, so Thailand, Vietnam, Myanmar, and it entered India through the northeast. Now it tried to find similar habitats and tried to kind of essentially colonize the country. So the path that it took was the Eastern Ghats, and it went south, hit Sri Lanka, and then started climbing up the Western Ghats. Now, because it was separated from the vernal hanging parrot, the Sri Lankan hanging parrot, over years, it formed its own species. You can see another interesting thing in the Oriental Pied Hornbill. So again, so Oriental Pied Hornbill and the Malabar Pied Hornbill essentially started out with a common ancestor, which came in from the Orient region. And once it hit the Northeast, it started finding similar habitat. So it's kind of diffused over the Himalayas and over the Eastern Ghats and climbed up towards the Western Ghats. Now, what happened at this region, the population got separated. I hope everyone can see the pointer. So they were separated and they formed two different species, the Malabar Pied Hornbill, which continued further south, and the Oriental Pied Hornbill, which stayed in the Himalayan region and this small patch of Eastern Ghats. Now, over the years, when the Malabar Pied Hornbill started moving ahead and infused the Western Ghats, it took the Central India Highway, Central Highland Highway, and started colonizing again the same region that it came from. So that's why in this region, you can find these both species. But now they were two different species and they could not interbreed. That's why in this region, you find both the species. So this is how a species which essentially was has a common ancestor gets divided and then kind of reunites to form the diversity of the Indian subcontinent. Similarly, if you see the crimson and the vigor sunbird, which was again split into these two. Earlier, if you have older bird books, both these species are called crimson sunbird. But something interesting happened here. So after hitting the northeast, one branch took to the Himalayas. The other branch, instead of moving south through the Eastern Ghats, it chose the central highlands as the preferred mode of travel, and then it hit the Western Ghats from the northern area, and then it started diffusing south. That's why if you see the vigor sunbird, they are more common in the northern Western Ghats than the southern Western Ghats. So any species that you find in the map, which is more common in the northern Western Ghats. Essentially, they took the central highlands as the preferred mode of diffusion, while species which are more common, like the fairy bluebirds, which is more common in the south and get rarer as you go further north, essentially took the eastern Ghats as their preferred mode of transport. And same thing can you see in Malkohas, again, same story. So they took the eastern Ghats route, they colonized this area and Sri Lanka, and then they further climbed up the western Ghats. But in this instance, they were divided into three distinct species. Now, essentially, why these species are formed and why at some points these barriers are not crossed. So this can also be seen if you just study the eBird site. So between the, let's take Himalaya as an example. In Himalayas, there are gaps in the habitat. So if you see the whiskered euhina, which is kind of found all throughout the Himalayas, the striated euhina is found only restricted in the northeast region, up till Sikkim. So this means the striated euhina only could travel to a certain distance across the Himalayas, and later on, the whiskered euhina was more bold and it traveled further. So this can also be seen in woodpeckers. So essentially the Himalayan and the Darjeeling woodpecker, you can see they were divided by a gap. This gap is famously called the Kali-Gandaki gap, which is formed due to the Kali-Gandaki river. Now this can be seen in the south as well because of the Palghat gap. So the Nilgiri laughing thrush, or now it's called the black chin laughing thrush, is found in north of the Palghat gap, while the Kerala laughing thrush is found south of the gap. Now, essentially, most of you would have questioned that if birds can fly, why these gaps matter? So, in birds, there are some birds which will be more adapted to flying long distances. They'll be adapted more changes in temperature, more adapted to changes in the habitat. And these are the birds that proliferate the most across any region. The birds that are very restricted and they want only a certain type of climate or a certain type of habitat, they'll be very restricted to one area. And that is why you find these diversities occurring. I thank you for your patience and I hope you enjoyed the talk.
Thank you, Asif sir,
for your nice presentation,
for providing this wonderful information to our participants. So you can see here in chat box, you can ask whatever questions you want. Now the chat box is open, so Asif sir will give you answer one by one. So please type your question in our chat box is open. Please type your questions.
So guys, even if later on you have questions, you can always pass your question to the EIACP team, and I can always be very happy to answer them later as well.
Most of the participants are sending their thank yous. They have one questions, like Deep's specialization follow similar pattern across the world?
Yes, so essentially all animals and all living things will follow this part, this method of distribution. But depending on how adapt the animal is to essentially walk across or fly across regions, you'll find them distribution differently. So mammals, I'm not too expert in, but birds, definitely you can see this pattern all over the world.
Okay, thank you, Asif, sir.
Thank you. So there are a few more questions. Nankishu, do you have time? Do we have time to answer?
Yeah, we have 10 more minutes, so you can take this all these questions. Yeah.
Nankishorji, am I audible?
Sir, you are audible.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Asif, for the very nice presentation. I just wanted to ask about the diffusion that you have mentioned. Whether the birds have migrated from Africa towards India or from India towards India, towards Africa, does it like it is seen through the dating of fossils or what?
So you can essentially study these right now. So you don't even need to go into the fossils and ancient history. Like I told you, like the similarity of origin of a species and where they have the common ancestors in, that shows how the birds have diffused. So let me just share my presentation real quick. I'll not go in the presentation mode so I can see the chats as well. So essentially, so let me just go to that slide. Yeah, you can see the slide, right? So essentially there are two main types of diffusion that occurs. So one is if the bird is more tolerant to the climatic change. So if you see in the Himalayas, if you have ever traveled in Himalayas or seen photos, you see the northeast is much wetter, much warmer. And as you go further towards the west, it gets drier and colder. So the western Himalayas is very dry, very cold. The central Himalayas, not so much. And then you have the northeast Himalayas, which is essentially a rainforest area or tropical area. So if you have a bird, say like the whiskered ewina, while they are colonizing the place, so each habitat chain that they come across, so they'll colonize the area as they go further. Now this I'm talking about years and years and generation and generations. But at some point, there'll be some bird which will say, ki, oh, now these changes are just too large for me. I cannot adapt as quickly. They're not comfortable, as comfortable to me. So I'll just stop here. So that is what happens with birds like striated ewinas. While other birds kind of continue till they get to a point where they can't, the habitat change or the climate change is just too stark for them to cross over. Then you have birds like your rain babblers and certain laughing thrushes. So these, if you know what rain babblers are, these are small birds which kind of stay in the undergrowth. They don't fly too much. So even a small gap for them is a momentous journey that they need to take over. Now, some birds, some species of birds of the same species might take up the challenge because of seasonal changes. So if there's a drought and they need to find new foraging grounds, so they'll take that leap. So they'll take that big leap and cross that huge gap. Some birds will stay in that place and say, okay, oh, maybe the things do get better. And once that things get better, so this group of birds now essentially are stuck in one region of the gap. And the birds that kind of jumped ahead to the other side of the gap, now they are separated from their original species. Now, because over years and generations, these two will develop into two different species. And even when they mix, say for say thousands of years in the future, if this gaps gets nullified and these two groups of bird kind of combine, they will still not be able to breed again because now they are two different species. So this is how diffusion and this is how essentially spread of species takes place. Now this is more evident, at least to me, in birds because when you study these birds, you can see birds which have originated from one common cousin, but now are two different species. And that is what essentially speciation is. I hope I have answered your question.
Yes, please. Yes. Just wanted to continue with that, in one of the slides, you have showed ki some birds have migrated from Africa towards India. But does this, the darkness of the color shows the concentration of the birds in the map?
Yeah.
How many numbers?
Yes, yes. So if you go to eBird, so the darker the spot is, so it doesn't essentially technically give you the concentration of bird or higher density. Since eBird is a citizen science program, it shows how many times the bird has been recorded in this region, which mostly correlates with whether that bird is common in that area or rare in that area. But again, you'll have to understand that this is mostly a citizen science. So if you see gaps, like see, let me share my screen again. I think so it stopped. So I've just pulled up the eBird map. So if you see, you can see these gaps. That does not mean that the bird is not found there. It means that it has been not been recorded in this region. But you can make an assumption that it is found in this entire region. And the darker the color, the more frequently that the bird has been recorded in that region.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Can human activity create gaps within these regions?
Yes, yes, very much.
Larger impact.
Very much. So if you have a large stretch of forest, and due to human activity, these stretch of forest creates a big enough gap, definitely it will create gaps. But you have to understand that human development has been very new in terms of the length of birds and animals being existing on the earth. So the changes we will not be able to see right away, like species being formed because of human activity. But yes, it will definitely affect.
In fact, a term is used now by in geology to suggest that this is a different age now because of human activity.
Other participants, please mute your mic. So we will take this. We will take the last question. So remaining questions we can put all through email. So I request all participants, please write your questions. The email ID which you had given, like EIACP@bnhs.org. So, sir, we can take your question, so you can ask again, sir, please.
Yes, any more questions?
Yeah, the Anthropocene, that's what I meant. The idea of the Anthropocene.
Yes, definitely. So any gap that you create in a habitat, that will affect the distribution of species. And given large enough time, definitely they'll form into two different species if they have been divided between the two habitats.
Yeah, I have the last question, please.
One last question. When are you doing the next one?
So that you'll have to check with the with our team, and hopefully very soon.
Thank you.
May Thank I have you. The last question? I'm Murthy from Hyderabad.
Please, please, sir. We can take this last question. Yeah, please, please.
A very one word introduction. I'm the president of Deccan Birders, Hyderabad. My question, I put it in the question box as well, the chat box. Is the speciation normally found in smaller birds rather than the bigger birds?
Yes.
Across all species?
If you can see speciation, I wouldn't say dividing them into smaller and larger birds. We can divide them in groups that are... you can say smaller birds which are... they don't have a strong flight.
Mm-hmm.
If you see birds, as I told you, like the rain babblers will be more likely to form different species because even a small gap will divide the population. But birds which are good flyers and migratory birds, the speciation is far less. That is why the speciation that you see in migratory birds are far less compared to birds that are resident or forest dwelling birds, which don't migrate as much.
So this can be applied to any of these such species across the world?
Yes. So in terms of birds, I'll be talking in terms of birds only, but it can be applied across the world. So wherever any map that you pull up in eBird, and if you see, start searching species by species, you can see where the bird has been influenced from.
Okay. Would there be any website or any research going on this where I can refer to and read up a bit more?
So essentially, there's an amazing book by Trevor Price called Speciation.
Oh, Trevor Price. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so let me see if I can find a link to that bird, and I'll just put up in the chat. So it's an excellent book to read. Yeah, so I'm just putting up a Amazon link.
Yeah.
So this is an excellent book if you're interested in how species are found and
very much.
So Nankishwar, I think so we can
call it a day. Yes. Thank you, Asif sir. The book actually, State of Bird of India report, you will get all maps with latest information. So I will share the link through our WhatsApp group, because we have, you know, that all are the part of our WhatsApp group. So whatever questions you can, you will get the my contact number as an admin. So whatever questions you want to share through WhatsApp, then you can just WhatsApp me. Or I have already shared the email ID, eiacp@bnhs.org. So you can use both the way, and you can ask your questions. And we have, as I told you, we have a Bucero's newsletter, which is a very free of cost. You can take a free membership. So you just visit our website and download all the letters as well as all old publications. So thank you, Asif sir, for this wonderful webinar. And thank you all the participants for taking their patience and listening all the information which is shared by expert.
Just a closing vote of thanks. Thanks, Asif, today, besides Sparrow Day, is also International Day of Happiness.
Yeah.
So you have spread a lot of happiness today.
Yes. It's our
group. Please spread some more.
Yeah. Thank you, Anand.
Thank you. Thank you, Nankishwar, sir.
Yeah.
And thanks,
Asif. Yes. Yeah, as you know, today we are celebrating World Sparrow Day. So it's very important, because in urban area, the report which I have mentioned, like State of Bird of India, in the report they have mentioned that like house sparrow are gradually declining in metropolitan cities like Mumbai, Bangalore, Delhi, but it's stable in the small cities and villages, because they are getting their proper food, place where they can make their nest, and favorable climatic conditions. But in urban areas, they are facing a lot of problems because they don't get any place where they can build their nest. So we have to provide some platform. Like if you put a small bird nest in your balcony, then definitely sparrow will come to your house. So again, thanks our experts and all the participants, those who are present here. And as you know that we are part of our WhatsApp group. So whatever questions you want to ask, you just share through WhatsApp or email. So thank you again. Thank you. Now we are closing this session. Thanks.
Whether any certificates will be provided to the participants?
No. We will not provide certificates, because it's this webinar is only for sharing our knowledge with you. So we will not provide any certificate. Thank you. Okay. Bye.
Thank you. Very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.